sheep, you want it to really run out as fast as possible. So this one part number I mentioned is like a little, a fancy Harken block that's, you know, the right size to be class legal. It's got a little bit higher engage, high HTE means high threshold engage. And again, hopefully I'm not being too fancy here, but just trying to mention these things because they're ones that, you know, my notes after sailing with different people, you know, pop up. So anyway, that the, again, just to reiterate, the reason there is you want the ratchet to disengage on the jibe. So when the lazy or, you know, lazy sheet runs super smooth and has no friction running out. So those are a couple items to think about.
One of the questions that came up quickly, Kris, is whether you had perhaps had any pictures of the upgrades that you're referring to, or maybe what a resource might be. Would a guy like Ed Fury be a resource for some of these upgrades? Or
sure. Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, anyone could Google that Harken part and buy it on some wholesaler site if they want, or talk to their local rigger, that kind of thing. The specific stuff, yeah, the J-bar for the, and everybody see that now? Can you see the deck plan, Troy?
Yep.
Okay. So I'll go over this stuff in a second, but yeah, to finish your question. Yeah. The couple of the J bar things that hold the shrouds, what that is, in case anyone doesn't know, is it's a device that holds all three shrouds sort of in place at once so that you don't need to, you know, tie them off or do anything different. It's just a single unit that slides in and holds them in place. So they don't kind of unwind. And, maybe offline, or I don't know, Andy Graff or any other Chicago, some of them. And, I think even Dave Tufts has one also. So there's some people around in the fleet that have them. I'm not certain where to get them, but I'm sure Ed might be a good resource. So if we have a second here, Troy, you can monitor that chat. If you think something's, if you want to read it off, that's fine, but I'm just going to talk about this here. So if everybody can see my screen, this is sort of this is the sail plan and deck plan that they send to us sailmakers when a boat is new, so we can design sails for the boat. And I always like to look at the deck plan because it's kind of neat, you know, you can kind of see everything's to scale. So we can sort of measure things and determine, where things can go. The first year I started sailing the boat, we actually made a call without having the boat as to where to put those blocks. So if everybody can see my mouse, Troy, can you?
Yep.
So basically what I'm talking about with that turning block, you can see where I'm circling right now. That's the standard location. So if we could move that block up to this spot right here where my mouse is, again, not a huge deal. I'm not looking to tell everybody they need to spend money and drill holes in their boat, but if you know, one of the things that I think makes life a little easier. So you can move your turning block for the spin halyard up here. Reason being, you have a nice lead now, if you're watching my mouse, up to the winch. You know, it's just a clean lead. It doesn't cut through the cockpit as much. And if, you know, when you're sitting on, when you're on the weather side, if it's led here, the trimmer can be up in here and not have it kind of cross over everybody and be awkward. So that's one thing we're talking about. The other thing I'm going to hit on really quick, we have this deck plan, which is kind of cool to look at the boat in this view. I thought it was the cleanest way to point out some things. We're going to talk about weight placement. So my, looks like my video is freezing here, but you can hear me, I think. you can see right here, I'm a huge proponent of getting weight in the fattest part of the boat. Some boats I'll sail on, I'll even go so far as to kind of measure the widest, you know, with a tape measure and mark that spot on the deck. So that tells me, can you hear me, Troy?
Yep, you are breaking up a little bit, but I can hear you.
Hang on, having some, let me know if you can hear me.
Yep, we can hear you. Your video is freezing up a little bit, but I think your voice is still fine.
Hang on one second. Okay, can you hear me and see me now?
Yep, that seems a little better, yep.
All right, sorry. So one of the things I'm talking about here is looking for the widest part of the boat. You'll see in my later pictures, some people have crew that sit forward of the stanchion. And then this is a great way to visualize it. If you look there, and you look at this spot in the boat, it's quite a bit narrower than in this spot. So I kind of feel like you got to have a real good reason to have someone forward here. In very light air, maybe that's okay if you're just going to only have a couple people up on deck and you're not really hiking. But if you're looking to keep the boat flat and you're in 10, 12 knots plus, I think it's very important to have that weight. You know, if you look here right across from the winch, that's the widest part of the boat. So just something to think about. I think it's helpful to visualize that. And when we talk about weight placement, you can kind of see where, you know, what science this would be exactly. I guess probably physics, what the real difference in sort of writing moment would be. But I can tell you, I'm sure it's a pretty good percentage more if you had a heavier person in this spot versus here, right? So anyway, a couple of things I wanted to point out with the deck plan there. If anybody wants a copy of this, this also is something I shared. It's on Quantum's page. And sometimes they make kind of a cool gift if you ever wanted to have this sort of blown up by a printer or something. Go back to my PowerPoint here. So that's kind of, you know, a couple things on the deck and just kind of wanted to look at that. The other thing I'm going to hit on here is just a quick note about photos. Any of you that have heard me talk before, you know that I talk a lot about taking photos of sails and sending your sailmaker photos of sails with questions. Nobody does this enough, including myself. You know, I started looking for stuff for this webinar and I found that of all the boats when I go sailing, I don't take enough pictures. Pictures are tremendously helpful in determining, you know, repeatable settings. And also, I'm going to just pause here a second. And also in, you know, an analysis of the sail shape, you know, something doesn't look right to you. And then all of a sudden, you know, take a picture of it and send it to us and we can help you. Can you hear me, Troy?
Yep, we can hear you. You know, and I'd comment on that as well too. We do have, and Kris can help with this. We've got even on our website, a kind of a plan that suggests, you know, the best way to take pictures in order to get them in your sailmaker's hands for the best review, right? So you can take those, you can digitize them. Our designers can have a look at them and we can pinpoint some areas where there might be a little bit of tweaking that could be done to help with the shape, but it's not that difficult. I think in most cases, right, Kris, can be done with your cell phone camera today, right? You back with us? Yeah.
Yep. I don't know if it's, I'm sorry, maybe it's my internet that's acting up here. So I'm going to go back to a screen share here. Everybody see that?
Yep. Yeah. And while you're going to that, Kris, just one quick question around out the deck plan. Brandon reached out the question saying, you know, if you move that spin block forward, is that going to limit your ability to run the spin sheet to the weather winch and keep the grinder up to the weather side of the rail? I mean, have you had experience with that? Yeah.
No, good question. I think you want to move it just behind the comb, you know, just a slightly behind that winch, right? So that you do still have a clean lead to the weather winch and not just to the leeward winch. So yes, I would say maybe not all the way, perpendicular to the winch, but just a little bit aft of it. So you still have that lead.
Awesome. And then one more tip and comment from our resident IT guy, Graham Eager. He says, don't do video and screen share at the same time. Maybe that's what's goofing you up.
That's smart. I'll keep that in mind. All right. So I'm stopping my video, but I'm going to go back to this. Okay. Some reason I'm not able to move forward here. There we go. Okay, so back to photos. As Troy said, another thing I will share is that link. We have a link to an article on our site about taking pictures. So everybody looks at this picture on the right. That's a really nice looking mainsail. That's a shape that we want. It's a little bit open, if you will, as far as, you know, being not fully upwind, but it has the draft in a nice place. Another good picture, sort of more full on upwind here. But just the purpose of this slide, if you will, is basically just showing you the idea of pictures of your sails. Again, can't reiterate it enough. Send it to me, send it to sail, you know, whoever your sailmaker is. A lot can be learned from that, both from you, you know, the J70 I sail on, we'll take pictures every day at every setting and then make corresponding notes of where the rig is at. Right. And then you're really understanding what effect you're having. We were in a really high mode. This worked really great. You know, duplicating those settings, taking pictures and making notes of where your rig is at, is really the next level to really fine tuning your program and getting yourself to where getting up to speed is easy and you always know where you should be.
Yeah. Making notes to the rig and making notes of the wind conditions as well, too.
Okay. So that's kind of, gonna go back here. The next thing we're gonna talk about a little bit is weight placement. So this is the next sort of item on my slide here. Okay, so we'll go full screen here again in a second, but. Okay. So we're back to weight placement. We talked a little bit about this, you know, before in that deck plan, but now just want to tell you to be dynamic. One of the biggest things that I noticed between the top teams and the sort of, you know, learning or club level teams, if you will, that are not winning events is they're not being dynamic, right? The top teams are sailing the boat a little bit more, I don't want to say dinghy like, but I will, you know, just a little more, you know, quick on their feet and very dynamic with the weight. And the boat is light enough and enough like a smaller boat that you have to do this, especially when you're in, you know, transitional wind and you're in, you know, and you're in light air, you're trying to get the boat around maneuvers. A team that is very dynamic with their weight and when they're changing gears, if you will, is tremendously successful. And if you're not, and you're just sailing it like a big heavy boat, you won't be. So just reiterating the stuff again, upwind, weight in the center and no gaps. So what I mean by no gaps is no weight, you know, no, you're not having like any space between the people hiking on the rail, right? I'll show you some pictures here in a second that will go over this and reiterate, you know, how tight you want to be on the rail. Then back to my spot here. You want to be like, let's say plus or minus one spot on the rail for light air versus heavy air, right? So as you might imagine, lighter air, you could be a little further forward. And I say one spot, I mean like sort of a body width, if you will, right? So I have my mark on a lot of boats where the fattest part of the boat is and where I really want to concentrate everybody hiking. And if it's really light air and maybe there's a couple people only, not everyone on the rail, I might bump that spot forward just a touch, right, of that max spot and kind of ooch everyone on the forward end. And then vice, you know, the opposite of that in heavy air, you want to be back a bit more, mostly because of the boat and how it loads up, but also typically, you know, heavier air, a little more chop, and you don't want to be burying the bow either. So hopefully that makes sense to people. And then send two crew below deck when under 6 to 7 knots, especially if it's choppy. This is one I know a lot of people hate to do. I kind of hate to ask people to do it because it's not a ton of fun, but I can tell you it does make a pretty big difference, and it all has to do with being dynamic. Okay. So we'll talk a little about one of the sort of themes of this, of what I want to talk about is, and what I think the fleet was interested in is, you know, gear changing and how to kind of get the boat moving again. So again, what I've seen on the teams that are successful, it's like, okay, boom, you know, you find yourself in a hole, you're coming up on some motorboat wake. Before that even gets there, you know, your sails maybe are twisted off a little bit, you put the bow down, and then, and like, as soon as the boat heel angle, which you hear me talk a lot about, changes, immediately, boom, two people right below deck and to the low side, right? And kind of obviously as it would make sense, you can kind of rotate those people around, you know, you can be on the low side. And then as it gets maybe a tiny bit breezier, you can move those two crew up to the weather bench And then as it comes up, you can have them come up and, you know, tiptoe back on deck and get up to full hike. But it's all very dynamic and it has to be active with that. Helmsperson should really be forward of the traveler when it's light, you know, as much as possible. Sometimes, you know, depending on the skill of the helmsman, you know, if they can sort of handle the main in the with the fine tune for a bit or something, and it's really light, maybe you have two people below, you have, you know, the other people to leeward, and the helmsman, you know, sitting as far forward as they can. You know, sometimes the tactician or main trimmer may be standing in the companionway so they can still look around. That kind of dynamic movement is important. Coordinating a roll tack in light air, also important. And always move to keep a steady heel angle. The crew should not have to be reminded of this, right? Everybody knows that feeling. I say to a lot of people I sail with, it's all the feeling in your seat. You know, if you want to call it your butt, then that's what it is, right? But it's, you feel the boat load and unload. And I think, you know, once you've been sailing for a year or two, most crew have a little bit of a feel for that, right? You can kind of feel when the boat gets sticky, and that's your cue, you know, sit up, lean in, or make a move to go low side to try to keep the boat with that steady feel and heel angle. A downwind, again, you know, similar kind of thing. You got to be pretty dynamic. One of the big things we've learned in the last couple of years is really pushing the weight pretty far forward when it's really light air and you're trying to get going downwind and you're not really, I would say, certainly under 7 knots. I don't mean all the way like on the bow, but I mean 2 to 3 people, like at least 2 people at the, you know, at the mast or just in front of it. And maybe the bow person is like, you know, to the stanchion in front of that. Getting the back end of the boat out of the water a little bit and getting that weight forward is very helpful. Windward heel, critical for sailing deep. I think everybody has seen, you know, photos and other stuff we'll look at in a second here where, you know, you've got to have the windward weight, right? And you want to have everybody's weight concentrated right at the shrouds and of course, shifting aft when it's windier. So I'll skip ahead for a second to go to, you know, downwind and some spots. Obviously, you have 3 different sort of modes here, right, that we can talk about. This shot, which isn't the greatest shot, but you can see people are all to windward. I will share another spot here with you guys. Hang on. Where am I looking? I'm sorry. All right. So here's one in Chicago. Everybody can see that, right? So that's kind of lighter breeze and everybody's, you know, to the weather side. Can everybody, Troy, can you see that?
No, it hasn't popped up yet, Chris.
Okay, hang on.
It hasn't opened up yet.
How about now?
There you go.
Okay. So yeah, if everybody can see that, you know, that's kind of a lighter mode where you're just starting to kind of get weather weight and try to sail deep. One of the things to talk about here on this team that I sailed with a bunch in hijinks, people like to stand up a lot downwind. But you can see the gist of it is that you're standing to weather, your weight's pretty, you know, pretty condensed and at the shrouds. You really want to see that. One of the little factors about standing up, which, you know, I'm not saying you need to do, but one thing to keep in mind, which I'll show you guys in another shot here, is, you know, one factor, I guess, in a little bit lighter breeze is you see that boat 21 right behind us there. You know, you don't want to telegraph a jibe. So something to think about, again, when you're sailing in these boats, everybody knows, you know, you're in that spot downwind and everybody's been in that lineup where everyone's, you know, all the boats are lined up right behind, right? And these ASIMs, everyone knows it's like whoever can get lowest is going to control their own destiny, and otherwise you can get jibed on and rolled. So it's very important to be ready to jibe without having everyone sort of getting up and monkeying it around, and then the boat behind you has a chance to jump you. So just something to think about is to be as stealth as possible when you're gonna jibe. right? It should be everyone's whispering to each other, like, okay, on three, no one move, we're gonna just go. So just some of the stuff to think about.
So Kris, two quick questions on the angle, on heel angles. Ted Lockwood's asking, you know, in your opinion, what's the optimum heel angle that you found sailing upwind in, let's say, 12 to 18 knots?
Okay. If you give me a second here, I kind of did jump ahead and didn't go through new tuning guide. I will just finish up this downwind section, and I'll jump back to the tuning guide, which has actually heel angle on it and some other stuff that we can go over.
Yep.
Did you hear me?
Yep. Thanks. Yep.
Okay. Okay. Can you hear me, Troy?
Yeah, we can hear you, Kris. You haven't changed your screen at all yet.
Okay. Yeah. No, I know. I'm having technical difficulties here.
Mm-hmm. While you're working on that, I see your question, Lauren, about not slight heeling downwind. I think it depends on the wind condition, right? I think in these boats, trying to heel the boat to weather, especially if you're in a tactical situation where you're trying to sail low, obviously is a better scenario. I would assume if the breeze gets really light, having a little bit of heel angle probably does help the boats downwind. So I think that's probably, as Kris would suggest, one of those dynamic things that it's going to be based a little bit on the wind conditions.
All right, I'm coming back here.
I see. There you go. Paul's asking a question about the tack length from the bowsprit when sailing deeper. I do see in the picture here that is eased off. It looks like maybe 10, 12 inches. Again, varies based on the type of pressure you have, Kris, I would assume, right?
It does. And that's some of the stuff I talk about in mode here, which we can talk about. Gotcha. But just wanted to go through. Here's a quick one, right, of that picture of everyone's been in this spot, sort of you're sailing downwind and you're trying to kind of get the jump on the guy behind you, right? And you can see the two boats here, everybody's kind of in, you know, pretty good position. You're in that mode where you're trying to get weather, weight, and control your own destiny to be able to jive on the boat in front of you. So that's just a position there where you can see how critical it is to be, you know, sailing as deep as you can, getting your weight out and trying to get down. I mean, everybody here on the call probably has been in this spot, right? It's just all about trying to sail lower than the boat in front or behind you so you can jibe and control your own fate here. So this obviously is a much different mode where you're training and hopefully we'll get back to some of that. Maybe Charleston will bring this a day or two, but it's not very often in the 88 where you have the jib out and your bow up racing. It probably is, you know, let's say 18-ish plus to be in that mode. So just to kind of, you know, hit on that. But I'm going to go to the guide really quick here, and then we can take a quick break at the guide and see if anybody has any questions. And then I will talk about a little bit more of the gear changing stuff. And then we'll move on from there. Just give me a second here. Yeah, I apologize. Normally have rocket fast internet, so I'm not sure what's happening here, but apologies. okay, let's see here.
Yeah, it's a good comment, Jimmy. I see you just brought up that you know, that, that weather heel does help project a kite out further from underneath the main. And, you know, again, opens up that slot a bunch, which obviously helps the boat then kind of drive down a bit as well too. So that's a great comment. Yeah, we you've got the guide up now here, Kris.
Okay, super. All right. So here's, again, I shared this with everybody in the chat tab, I believe. So everyone should have this. If you don't now, I can send it to you offline, but just wanted to kind of go over this. It's pretty great addition. Still a work in progress as any guide is, but you can see this one provides some different tabs at the bottom where you can add your own notes and you could, you know, play with this and change things yourself as you see fit. One of the things we added a little bit here, if you look where I'm pointing, is the jib lead number. Okay. So kind of go over this pretty quick as, you know, without getting too in depth. I know it's, I struggle here because there's so much to cover, but want to try to just kind of point a few things out to you guys and kind of hit a few topics without droning on forever here. But yeah, as far as the jib leads go. So typically speaking, you're at your base setting, right? Which as one of the commenters said, here's your 39-22-16. If you did want to, as somebody chimed in on the chat, you could make what I'd call a tuning matrix, which is just counting, you know, at the dock, you get your base setting here at, you know, let's say 10 to 12 or in that range. And then you're at 39, 22, 16, right? Which here is almost a little bit of a typo here. I should change this really to 10 to 14 to be fair. But you're in that 10 to 15 range as base, 39, 22, 16. If you wanted to make a what I'd call a tuning matrix, you take your turns, your minus two, your minus one, minus one and a half, and then you'd measure what the shrouds read. You could write that down. That's always something to do. The only problem with that I see is that on the water, you really can't use your gauge unless you have the mainsail down, which is kind of sometimes a pain in the neck. So that's why typically you just kind of setting your base at the dock. Then sometimes I'll try to share my video here for a second. If I don't crash and burn. If anybody can see, I'm holding up a pair of calipers, but basically you can use a pair of calipers to get your base setting, right? And then you measure the gaps on your shrouds. You write that down. That could be your way on the water that if you get out of tune, you know, you can go back to your caliper numbers and find your base.
I think it's a great process to go through. One of our counterparts associates within the company, Wally Cross, has a process that he uses called system sailing. And it goes along a parallels with this, with your tuning guide. Is really what you're looking to do is have repeatable settings. So, you know, whatever method you decide to use, being able to replicate those on a consistent basis, which obviously takes some work, takes some practice, takes a lot of notes, et cetera. But that's really what you're aiming toward, right? Because, and as Kris said, it's difficult to use the gauge while you're out in the water. So having the calipers, having a distance between, you know, the pins and the shrouds that you're using to measure and being able to duplicate or replicate that while you're on the water is a really big key to this process. So what do you think, Kris?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So just to kind of hit on a few more things here, if you guys notice these little asterisks here underneath are kind of explaining to you one of the most important ones here, the jib lead, which I recently just sort of added in here at the behest of a few people that were sort of saying, yeah, hey, how come we don't really have a number for your jib lead? So what I noted here is these are just factory screws from the aft end of the track. So your most common area you're living right around three screws, if you will, on the track showing from the back end. So that would be, you know, the back end of the car would just be past three of those screw holes showing is a pretty good base setting for your J1 jib lead, at least for the quantums anyway. Right. And I guess what I would say is, you know, don't get too caught up in exactly these numbers. I don't really have numbers for 18 plus because when you're into the J3 or J2/3, whatever you want to call it, Obviously it's a shorter LP sale, so it's a little, you know, the leads aren't, I just don't sell there enough to give you a solid number on that. But they're probably in a slightly, you know, the slightly different spot. The one thing I would say is the airing on the jib lead back, I think is a nice place to be, because you can create shape in the bottom of the foot of the jib with your inhauler pretty easily, right? But if your jib lead is too far forward, you're really going to struggle to close off. You're going to close off the top of the sail quite a bit. Okay. So we really don't want to do that. That top mark on the shroud, lining that up with your jib leech on your J1 is a very, very critical tool. So I'm constantly looking at that to make sure that upper telltale is flying. The J1 is a pretty full, powerful jib. So as soon as you're in 10 plus knots more, you have to work really hard to flatten that part out and not overbake the jib. And you'll stall that top telltale and the boat will really get sluggish and slow down. But you don't want to give away height, obviously. So again, like I said, having the jib lead back a bit, and you can play with the inhauler a good amount to kind of get you that shape you're looking for. And then if it gets too much, you can ease it off pretty easily. And it's nicer because you can ease that from the weather rail versus the lead is usually on the low side. A couple other things, you know, read through all this stuff. A lot of super great information here. This is pretty extensive, talking about target heel angles. If you look at setup picks, okay, here's the markings we're talking about on the inhauler, you know, where the rail is. You want to be, you know, if you can be living around the handrail here, that's a great spot. That means you're getting the sail in pretty hard and your pointing is going to be better. Sail chart, not super useful for, you know, just buoy racing, but does give you a little basis for when we use the other sails. For reference, I have never used an A3 in a class race in my entire career of sailing J88s. Not to say it would never happen, but we never have. Here's the targets we were talking about, which are pretty helpful. These are pretty accurate. Scott Nixon and a couple other guys at Quantum helped develop these, and we talked about heel angle. So here's another great tool here. Okay, so here's your heel angle numbers. Again, these are pretty close guides. You can see the boat heels quite a bit after 10 knots. It's hard to get it sail too much flatter, but these are pretty good numbers, right? In that 8 to 10 range, you probably want to be sailing somewhere in 10 to 15 degrees of heel. And it'll give you some downwind also. Like anything, it all depends on the instruments you have. If you have these instruments that give you this data, great. You know, if you don't, it's not a total necessity. You could just get a gauge, you know, one of the floaty gauges at least would get you some degree of calculating that. Some boats also have fore and aft trim, which if you do have, would also be helpful for downwind, right? You'd probably want to be in a -1, -2 down by the nose mode. Can you hear me, Troy?
Yep.
Okay, lost. So here's a couple sail picks. Okay, here's a really good looking main. You know, good bit of backstay, but the draft is where we want it, looking pretty flat. Here's the jib. Okay. Here's a nice setup pick showing you the inhauler and the handrail. Again, look through this stuff. There's other information here about battens. If you wanted to get fancier with kind of keeping an eye on what battens you had in and thought you might want to go, let's say, heavier in the top batten, in the jib, in the upper end of the range or things, this is just kind of giving you what the class battens are. So if you ever lost them, you knew what to have. There's crew info. You could fill this in and have information in for different regattas, schedule stuff. Anyway, great resource. I don't want to drone on about this too much, but it's here. And, you know, feel free to make comments and make notes and anything you want.
Well, one of the questions that came up, Kris, and I guess I didn't realize this, but it says on the guide that guide's set up for a hull spar, and sounds like maybe some of the boats might have a Selden mast. Is the guide going to change a lot in your experience?
Not too much, no. You know, the one thing I'd be wary of, at least in the you know, only basis I have really for the Selden mast is on J70s, where we originally had a Southern mast, and then Selden started making the mast. And in the J70, the Selden mast, which is the newer rigs, are stiffer by a good amount. So, you know, there may be some slight adjustment to the, you know, to the amount that the mast bends. And what I would tell you about, which I'll show you guys in some pictures, is, you know, just kind of monitoring the lower tension. One of the biggest takeaways or easy things to think about without getting too complicated with the tuning guide is, you know, the backstay, which I'll talk about, is such a critical control, right? You want to use that for a lot of different items. And when you're pulling the backstay on really hard and the mast starts to bend a lot, eventually you'll get the main to sort of, you know, overbend and you get wrinkles in it. And if you had the Selden mast and it was stiffer, that might take longer to get there. In which case you could get away with carrying a little bit less lower tension. Just think about it this way, guys. If to keep it simple, if you pull the backstay on really hard and you feel like you need it to depower and the main gets too flat, you need more lower tension, which will straighten the mast and keep it from overbending that way. And the flip side is, if you keep pulling on it, you know, a ton, and the main is still full, then maybe you have too much. But that's a critical, you know, sort of telltale sign to just kind of be, you know, wherever your shrouds are at. Let's say you get caught out of tune and you need to put a bunch of backstay on. If you can get away with one little quick change, you might be able to just adjust your lowers as needed to sort of get yourself back in line. Any other questions on that? You know, I'm listening as we move myself back to another spot here.
Yeah. Nope. I think we've got a bulk of the questions answered. I know, okay. One came up earlier from John about your tapes up at the spreaders. I think he, yep. The question was, is do you typically use three tape markings at the spreaders, and how far are you spacing those apart?
I'm trying to think that I believe we just have two marks on the guide. For, you know, one for the upper spreader, one for the lower. Okay. You can add, for sure, you know, if you were going to do that, what I would suggest is using, you know, putting the mark per the guide, which I find to be very, very accurate for lining up the leeches to look good. Yep. But maybe put one on either side of that if you go with three, but have the quantum numbered, you know, spot be the middle of those three would be what I would recommend. But they are, if you don't have those on your mast, you need to get them on there because they're a super critical tool in sort of looking at the leech of the sail and getting things set up right.
All right. Ted came up with another question here. So do you find in chop, do you soften the lowers for more power, for more punch in the sail?
Possibly, you know, if you're tuned properly, you probably shouldn't, you know, it would just be, let's say, less backstay, you know. If you are too loose on your lower, in theory, you're really flattening the sail, right? You're kind of bending it more and making it a bit flatter. So you might not want to do that.
Yeah. I mean, I would tend to look at head state tension and things like that as you're into more chop, right? With this boat.
Correct.
Yep.
Correct. So I'm just going to touch one more time on the downwind mode changing just a bit, and then we'll shift to upwind, where I think a lot of other questions lie about backstay and headstay sag and things like that. And then we can take another question or two and I'll roll into the Charleston part. And then I don't want to, you know, going to give people a chance to answer things at the end here. Okay. Getting there. We'll go in here. Sorry. Trying to find my downwind spot I was looking at. Okay. So downwind, one of the big things to talk about here in, and that I think is that I could be something good to share here is communication of, you know, spinnaker trimmer to driver, right? I mean, that's really the sort of the main bullet point of any successful downwind sailing. So I'd give you two points here. Determine a heading or a speed to reference the goal for the driver. You know, for instance, no slower than 5.6 knots, as low as possible, while maintaining 5.6 is the goal. So sometimes, which I'll touch on, you know, at the end here, you know, it depends on the skill level of the driver, right? If somebody's really new and they don't quite grasp the, you know, trying to get low, and they're sort of more of a speed hungry driver that is always sailing hotter angles, sometimes you can give, you know, give a driver sort of a heading, right? That kind of seems right to get you in the mode. And I'm talking here from, let's say, the tactician's role or someone on the boat that's more or less responsible for managing the direction of the boat and the tactics, if you will, whoever that is on the boat. Sometimes it could be the driver, in which case, you know, then they'd have the skill to, this wouldn't really apply to that. But a lot of times, you know, if you're just starting out and you have someone else that you really trust on the boat, they have a real feel for sailing these, you know, an asymmetric boat and soaking and so forth. You know, I sailed with Terry Hutchinson a couple of weeks ago on a J70, and we've got, you know, largely a somewhat more inexperienced driver that we sail with. And he was pretty key on sort of keying in a heading, right? This was in flatter water, as I say here in my last comment, but it kind of helped to avoid that crash and burn that we all don't want, right? It was like, let's, you know, the between the other brain trust in the boat, we could kind of come up with a heading that felt right for as low as we should be going and kind of keeping the boat on track to sailing a low angle and making it fast, right? And as you're trimming, whoever the trimmer is, you know, this is the kind of thing to work on as a crew, is to kind of get a feel for the boat and really have input. Because the boats that are super successful are taking a ton of input from that spinnaker trimmer as to what he feels and what he says. So you want to really be thinking about, like, okay, I got good pressure. Oh, as soon as you feel that slight bit of loss of pressure, you need to communicate that immediately to the driver so that he knows we really don't want that, what I call crash and burn, which is just a mode where you can get in a vicious cycle. Sailing these boats in light air downwind, where you just keep trying to sail low because that's what we all want to do. And then the speed, you know, you're trying to do 5.6, and then all of a sudden you get 2-3 degrees lower, and all of a sudden you're doing 4.8. And you're like, oh man, what happened? Now you got to heat way back up and get the speed up. So the whole cycle here is we want to avoid that as much as possible. So I guess my one big takeaway here is for you guys, you know, for the next Avant regatta or the beginning of the season, really work on that and determine whether you can kind of feel a speed that kind of gets you safely in that low mode, right? Where, you know, you're kind of like, let's say you know, 5.5, 5.4, as far as a low number, you've sailed off that cliff a few times, like in practice or on the first run. So now you're saying, you know, all right, let's try 5.5, 5.6, and let's really try to never get slower than that, right? And I think everybody's understanding where I'm going with this. And it's hard to always determine that, but the more you practice it and kind of keep an eye on your boat speed and your number, the more it can be very helpful in sort of adapting that change and changing it based on the conditions, right? You're gonna adjust it. The next leg, it could be, you know, 12 knots and the first leg was 10. So now that number's higher. But generally speaking, you know, you get alone for a few minutes, you get a feel for what that number is. And these kind of things really help when you're not next to another boat, right? You're not always neck and neck with a boat where you can tell directly what's happening. So you want to work on these things so that when you're a little bit more off on your own, you know you're sailing the boat properly. So hopefully that kind of hits home with people a little bit. Understand that. So now I'll just talk about upwind, target speed, heel angle. So in this upwind mode, we're talking the same kind of thing here. We're talking, you know, trying to kind of be one with the boat and be dynamic with gear changing and keep things consistent and working the boat through different breezes, So one of the things, obviously, similar thing upwind, you know, downwind is a target speed, but a little easier to determine upwind would also be a healing, right? And whether that's a numeric figure that you might have up on the bulkhead, or if it's just a feel of the boat, you know, in your seat, or just your constant feel of that heel angle, you want to really keep that steady. So again, super dynamic with all the controls to keep that consistent. The backstay, we'll talk about that real briefly, because I think that was another, you know, it's got to be played a lot. You want to really, I'm getting a note that my audio is low. Can you hear me okay? Right.
Sorry, I muted myself there. No, I can still hear you.
Just one. Yep. All right. Every now and again, I get a notice about, you know, something that tells me the audio is low or something. So
no, you're good.
Yeah. So I'm just going to continue. Okay, good. So the backstay, you really want to, this is something, you know, played a ton that I've figured out from the very beginning of this boat, is such a super critical control. So if you set the boat up to the guide for the headstay length, which I think is a very good and accurate number that everybody should use, at least with quantums. I don't know if North or anyone else has something different, but it sets up to where, you know, the boat has an appropriate amount of headstay sag when the backstay is eased off and you're trying to create power. But one of the most important things to keep in mind is you really, as soon as you determine you're in a mode where you want to be pointing and thinking about in-hauling, you can't really let that headstay sag, okay? Because what happens if you ease the backstay off too much, the headstay sags, you have the in-hauler on, now you're just dragging the bow down and the back end of the sail is super full, backwashing into the main, and you just have an incredibly inefficient sail shape. So I just think that that's something everybody on the boat needs to be in tune with, is sort of keeping an eye on that headstay sag, which I am just like a hawk looking at. So, you know, sure, you're going to go through chop, you're going to ease off your backstay, you're going to put the bow down a little, easy in hauler, get through that chop. And then as soon as you're through that and you're back in a flat water, steady heel mode, you want to be pulling that backstay on enough that you make sure that headstay is pretty damn firm. And the windier it gets, the more you want that thing to be like a piano, you know, super straight and no sag. And I would tell you, again, watching your spreader marks at the leech with the in-hauler, like we talked about, is just super critical. So you're constantly looking at that and making sure you're pushing the envelope to trimming the in-hauler and the sheet in enough that you're, just when you stall the upper leech telltale, as soon as that does, you maybe burp it a tiny bit and that's your sweet spot. But you really want to be constantly playing that game. And the backstay is a big help with that, right? The windier it gets, if you don't have the backstay on hard enough, you know, if it's in a windy mode, everyone's full hiking, it's 15 plus. If you're not on the hairy edge of inverting the main or having the, you know, having it look too flat, then I can pretty much tell you for sure you don't have enough backstay on. You really need to have that on, flattening out the main, getting the headstay really firm. And that jib is such a critical tool. So hopefully a little bit of that hits home. Here's a couple upwind shots. So everybody can see my screen here. Basically, you know, again, showing the hiking. I'd even contend there's a little too much gap between the jib trimmer and the next guy there. But, you know, it's a pretty good look. Everybody's pretty close together, hiking hard. You can see the main is pretty flat there. If you look at 27's main versus 2 down there at the, you know, in the other section, you can see it just looks like a much fuller sail and just is not as efficient. So that's kind of the look you're going for. And you can almost see a little bit of inversion wrinkles in the main because the backstay's on pretty hard. But if you don't have that headstay really firm, you're not going to be able to trim the jib properly, especially when it's windy. The one thing I'll say, this, you know, our J1, the Quantum J1 is a very powerful, big number one, which I think gives us a great advantage in under 10 knots. But in 10 to 10 plus, 10, 12 plus, till you get close to the J3, you know, it's a pretty full, powerful sail up top. So it makes it even more critical to keep that headstay firm. Here's a quick picture of some sail analysis stuff that we did way back in Key West, where you can, you know, if you send us pictures or take pictures off the boat, again, you can't, I don't know if you can see the bow here. In fairness, it was, you know, caught at probably a bad time, but you can see in this picture, a big gap between the guy and the bow, you know, and the bow in this boat digging a bit more in that wave versus the other boat. I've shown this picture a handful of times in different stuff, but just giving you a few visual clues to the things that I look at and in determining where to sit and how to hike out. Here's another upwind shot. You know, you can see, if everybody can see the you know, the jib. This is, I remember this, and it's like the upper end of the J1, where you almost probably should have been in the J3. And you can see how powerful that foot is. Really, the lead should have been even further back. That much round, if you guys can see where my mouse is, in the foot of the jib in that kind of breeze is a pretty powerful look. And you probably wouldn't want that unless you were just about to power through some waves, right? So it's, you know. The other thing, Troy, you can see this picture okay?
Yep, sure can.
Okay, so if everyone can take note where my mouse is, right around my knee here. This is something I wish I had a little better shot, but for those of you that cross sheet, it's, I think, a great spot where I've placed it on most of the boats I sail. We place a mark on that jib sheet right about the point where it reaches the combing. So you can see the cross sheet from down low going across, and there's a whipped mark on that jib sheet that is allowing, you know, that is, and if, again, hopefully you guys can see my mouse. Now I'm down this side just showing you, but like the mark would be like between the combing and the base of the winch, right? And in that range, it's a great indicator to being on the rail and for anyone else that's hiking out. Everyone's full hiking, and I look at that mark. Now I know the jib's trimmed in all the way. And I know from trimming it in and having that repeatable mark that that's going to equal, you know, the jib top telltale flying and all those kinds of things. So it's just another, you know, great trick is to for sure have some, if you do cross sheet, which I highly recommend doing in, you know, anything over 8-9 knots, having a mark on that sheet that's somewhere right around the point it meets that winch, and have obviously in the same exact spot on the other sheet marked. And that really helps, you know, everyone on the rail determine where you're at, so that let's say the person trimming the main, which is me in this case, could just take a quick turn or so on that jib, and now I know where I'm at, right? If I burp it out to go through a wave or to go around something, now I know exactly where I'm at. I don't have to go down low and let the boat tip over. Right, those are the kind of things that make a big difference. So
we had a question pop up, and I think if I understand it, Lauren, I think what you're asking is how do you get those measurements? I mean, how are you making those settings, those markings on the sheet? Sure. And again, I mean, I think that. And Kris, you can verify this, but I mean, that's going to come from your practice day, right? You're going to go out, you're going to try to sail in these different conditions. And as you get the sails set up to where you want them, somebody's going to make a quick mark with a Sharpie or something. And then you're going to further mark that when you get back at the dock so that you can, again, replicate that when you're out racing.
Yes, absolutely. That's a great practice day. You know, it's where you take your notebook out on the practice day and you make a list of some things you want to do. And that should be one of them top on the list. We just did this exact thing on Exile when I did the regatta in St. Pete with them. you know, we started looking at that. We made a little bit of a Sharpie mark that wasn't super bold until we sort of, you know, tested it in a couple different conditions. And then we said, all right, this is, you know, this is a great spot. And then once when you're cross sheeting, you kind of make that mark to where it's, you know, between, let's say, giving yourself a range between the combing and the base of the winch, you know, let's say in theory at 90% to 100% of jib trim, right? So that you know the distance off is relative to that, if that makes sense. And then what you would do is just make sure that you have, you know, the same mark in the exact same distance away. You just string out the jib sheets on the dock and then, you know, pull them both to the same spot and make a mark so you know they're in the same place. Yep. I think it goes without saying there, obviously, that you need to make sure you're the way you hook up your sheets to your jib is the same every time, right? You can't be tying a knot that's different each time. Otherwise, those marks won't work. So last thing we go here, we're changing gears, which again was on our sort of agenda. Backstay is a crucial control. Like I said, weight movement is quick and efficient to maintain heel angle. Again, hitting on that. Mainsail controls and your changing gears are extremely active. Anyone knows, I probably to a fault, maybe it's like an OCD thing, but that has sailed with me. I never, ever for a second stop playing with the main sheet, whether it's the fine tune, the traveler, the backstay control, anything there, and only thing I'm focused on is just literally trying to keep the same feeling in my seat, if you will, and in the heel angle of the boat and the load of the boat. And so, you know, as it gets lighter and stuff, it's everything's got to be just the person on the main has to be super active with that. Traveler up, traveler down, easing sheet. And again, small jib adjustments make a big difference. Again, right to my point about that mark, huge, huge help having that mark. Then you're on the weather rail, you go through a light spot, you bump it out from the base of the winch to the combing. Now they relay to the crew, okay, the jib's at 95% now. Okay, we're back up to speed, bring it into 100. But those little adjustments in such a high aspect sail that we talk about, if you ease it out from that mark to the winch to the combing, let's say it's 2 inches of sheet, that makes the upper leech and telltale is now way off or way closed based on just that little movement. It makes a huge difference. So you really want to make sure to get that right. And the same thing, adapting and setting a new target boat speed as soon as possible when conditions change, I think. And that can be a loop between the driver and the tactician and a main trimmer, and just to say, all right, I think, you always try to verify that against another boat first and foremost, but also, against your polars or any sort of targets you have set up. I don't know, we could take a quick break here if anybody has some questions. And then I was going to move on to Charleston and then sort of wrap up for a little Q&A at the end.
So just over an hour into the presentation, and I put up into the chat box both Chris's email and my email. And if anybody wants to reach out, again, Chris has the bulk of the information here, but he'd be glad to, to deal with anybody offline here with some questions or comments that you might have. One question did come up earlier, and I think Iris helped a little bit, but I don't know a lot about these boats, but I do know that there are upgrades, right, to the spin takedown system, depending upon what you want to do. And I suspect if you ask two people their opinion on some of the takedown methods, you might get three different answers, right? I mean, I think there is some opportunities with the boat to look at that, but I don't know, Chris, if you have a quick comment on that or whether that's something that becomes a bit more lengthy.
No, I mean, it's certainly, I'm a big fan of the takedown, the string system, but a bunch of boats I've sailed on recently don't use them, and that's fine too. There certainly are pitfalls to them and things that could hang you up. When they work perfectly, I think they're an advantage at mark roundings, especially in breeze. But again, it's kind of personal preference, if to what you and your team want to achieve, and also where you're sailing. I think some of the guys that went to San Francisco, I think felt a little bit more need, like that would be a nice little tool to have, because, you're coming in often really hot into a mark and with not a lot of options to have time to take it down or to make a big dig down or other things that you might do when you're sending crew forward. But for, a lot of the sailing we do on the lakes, it's not as big a game changer in my mind. So.
Yep, gotcha. And Jimmy asked the question, are you able to adjust the shrouds while you're racing in the boat, or are they set?
Yep. You're not. And I want to adjust, the other thing I didn't hit on, which I'll do quick. You mentioned the tack line ease, right? In that one picture.
Yep.
Which, yes, I think sometimes you would do. I don't do it a ton. I mean, there's a pretty small window in that. I would say that window coincides closely to a time when I would consider trying the wing on wing move, which is, you know, probably somewhere in that 9 to 13 ish range, where it, you know, it might be a nice bonus. You know, oftentimes if you don't have that in your arsenal, as far as where you are boat on boat, yes, if you're really trying to soak super low, I would say, you know, in that 12 knot range is probably a great, a time when, you know, or even maybe just a touch more, where you could, that would gain you something. If you really wanted to sail deep, you could ease the tack line maybe 6 inches and let the kite rotate a little bit more. But in general, this kite is pretty built for running. So it's, you know, the luff link is already pretty long and it's really sold out pretty hard for trying to sail deep. So you could go too far and the kite could get unstable, but.
Right, right. Yeah. We've got a, I think it's a question from Annie. Maybe this comes from your participation with them at the last event, but Annie's comment or question is driver communicating level, driver communicating level of helm for adjusting traveler and backstay. I mean, how much info are you looking at?
I lost you, Troy.
Do you have me now? Can you hear me now, Chris?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. No, the question from Andy was, is as a mainsail trimmer, how much communicating do you want from the driver on what level of helm he has in terms of you making adjustments to either the traveler or the backstay?
Awesome question. I think I want a lot. I mean, it's some drivers have a feel for that, and some very good drivers, you know, don't really, maybe just don't pay attention to that enough or think about it enough. But I think that you definitely want to be providing, as a driver, you want to be providing that feedback to your main trimmer for sure. As soon as you feel like anything, you know, as your helm increases, you want to be letting them know. And that lets the main trimmer know, hey, I could, in general, in my mind, that means, hey, we could probably carry some more backstay, which most of the time until you're getting to overbend is just going to equal better speed and better pointing if you're able to give, you know, to do more and the driver has helm enough to sort of scrub, if you will, and you're looking, you could take a little less and still have some feel. That's, you know, that's super feedback.
Yeah, yeah.
And the same thing if it gets really sticky, right? Like, oh, I got all of a sudden you got no helm, then it's the opposite. You know, backstay off, traveler up, ease the sheet, get the sail a little twistier, and doing that quickly.
Yeah, I think that's great feedback. We could spend a half an hour presenting, I think, just on communication on the boat. And I think each boat has a different way they look at how that communication should take place. But I know you touched on it. You know, the spinnaker trimmer has a significant amount to do with how the boat is driving downwind, and that communication process between the trimmer and the driver is really critical, and huge gains can be made there.
Yep.
And again, the same holds true for the driver and the mainsail trimmer on this boat and virtually any boat. I mean, that the trimmer is controlling the speed, and they're only going to do their job based on the input that the driver's getting, you know, especially as it relates to helm. So, again, I think those are some great points and great opportunities for every one of the teams on here to really go out and work on from a practice standpoint is develop the right communication for your boat and keeping everybody involved. Right? Before we go jump into this, I neglected to thank both John and Andy Graff, two of the owners in the Chicago area, for helping set this call up. We appreciate that. Appreciate the opportunity to be involved here. I think there was a question early on in the chat box about maybe securing a list of all the J88 owners. And John, right or wrong, I threw your name out as one that might be a good contact for that. I don't know who the class coordinator is right now, but you know, again, I think the more you guys as a class can communicate and get all the new owners involved in talking is a great opportunity too. So hopefully that works out well. I put those email addresses back up in the chat box, Amanda. So hopefully you're able to see them again. And again, feel free to reach out to either Chris or I after the presentation or anytime here moving forward. And with that, again, we'll let Chris jump into how to sail in Charleston. That's a topic that can probably just be covered in a minute or two, Chris, right?
No problem.
It's a wonderful venue, one of the awesome, most awesome venues you're going to go to. And I think for sure one of the trickiest, especially as it relates to currents and that sort of thing. So Good luck with this one, Kris.
All right, no problem. No pressure. No, I really appreciate everybody bearing with me on some of my technical difficulties here. Hopefully everybody's learning something. And yes, huge kudos to John and the fleet in Chicago. You guys have been just awesome cheerleaders for the fleet. And it's just great to see. There are very few fleets of boats of this size, you know, aside from, you know, 70s that are sort of seem to be actually growing again and getting great turnouts at events. And, you know, with the North Americans looking like a great turnout, I think it's a great boat to sail. I always enjoy sailing it. And I think we've got a good group here. So hopefully the whole class continues to stay strong. So yeah, on to Charleston. Those of you that have had the chance to sail there or do in the future, you know, hopefully what I share can give you some insight there and help out. All right. So yeah, here's our sort of high level approach. In general, like I'm writing here, Charleston is not so much a speed venue, if you will. Now, don't get that wrong to mean that you don't need to be going fast. It's just a very dynamic race course, one that highly rewards good, you know, pretty good starts and good boat handling, right? Having great mark exits, both upwind and downwind, managing the current, being super, you know, sort of proactive and nimble with moves and getting a jump on the fleet are some of the real big key points to Charleston. So when I'm sailing there, I'm really putting a premium. Sure, right out of the gate, you want to make sure you're going fast. Get that, you know, upwind tune-up stuff out of the way, but practice the, you know, the jibe set. Right. And there's times when you'll come around a mark and there's so much current that you just have to get on the other jibe and you're already inside the fleet and you're laying the mark just because, not because of the wind shift, but because of the tide. Right. There are often times where the legs just won't be square because they just can't be with the tides. So being quicker to a jibe set or to a takedown and getting inside people, those are the kind of things you really want to be really swift and good at Charleston. So those are my sort of brief two cents here. So tidal currents. I shared a video in here, which I find to be awesome. I shared with a couple guys last year, shared with Dutch and they ended up winning. So maybe that was the formula there. But the tidal currents are a big deal. This YouTube video, I don't know if you know, like I said, I shared it in the chat. It's a gentleman that's sailed a bunch in Charleston from several years back at Race Week and put out an informative video. It goes over all the courses and the, you know, the ebb and the flood at each one and where to go and where to look for. Very good video. It's pretty long, but I highly recommend looking at it. You know, take the time and go over it. It goes over each course and everything else. So that's for sure. If you can't get that or, you know, just email me and I can get it to you. So here are sort of the circles. If you guys look down here, circle three is where the 88s have been last couple years. I've also sailed circle one with the 88s before, but two is where, or three here is where you'll be sailing if you are doing Charleston. So here's sort of a chart. You guys are kind of, Patriots Point is where the main regatta headquarters are. If anybody's not familiar with that, there's a main shipping channel out here. a lot of buoys and indicators for current, but main shipping channel is the deep water. And then the rest of it here has some other deeper spots, but this is the race course area. A lot of geographic things and features to look for. A lot of flags to look for. Flag on Fort Sumter is a great indicator. You can see sort of when the sea breeze is coming in. So a lot of places on land to look for flags and look for things that might help you with your race. So here's sort of the tidal direction with max ebb. And you can see, again, this will be recorded so you guys can go back and look at this. Just also to reiterate, Quantum will be sharing a bunch of stuff. This was part of their slides and stuff from last year. So Quantum will be sharing probably a bunch of this stuff over the next week or so that might, you know, repeat a lot of this stuff, but just figured I'd try to focus a little more on the 88 course and help you guys out. Here's the max flood. So you can see kind of, you know, in that course three area, there can be sort of a split current. There are times when, if you guys can see my mouse here, that you'd be, you know, that larger red arrow coming right down the shipping channel, you might want to get into that some more versus at the top of the mark of the course, let's say in a, you know, in a southwesterly or a southerly, you might be getting a different direction of it. So one of the things that I highly recommend is if you don't have a chart plotter on your boat, one of the things I talked to some of you guys in the fleet about, getting out to the course area. And if you don't have a chart plotter that can sort of show you where you are or a copy of the chart, you know, get the little Navionics app, get something going on your phone that records you where you are and shows you the depth of where you're sailing in the course. And then you can really get a map. You can map out an idea of like, okay, the weather mark's going to be in, you know, 30 feet of water and there's more current this way. And you know, when we get down to leeward mark, we're going to watch out for this. So a lot of game planning goes into Charleston. You know, that's pretty important when you're looking at the current and coming up with your plan for the day. So you want to really do your homework, take a look at the charts. And when you get out on a practice day or the first day, you know, record your tracks so you can review it at night and figure out, you know, or what did the current do there when we were in this depth and so on and so forth. Here's the start of the flood. Nice picture of Exile there. So transitional time for the local sea breeze is kind of the trickier part. There is a pretty traditional, you know, sort of southerly, southwesterly sea breeze on a typical day that fills in around noon. So you're kind of looking for that. And, you know, if it's a high pressure kind of day, you might have very little wind in the morning and slight postponement or wait, and then that breeze will come in. You know, typically, you know, I don't want to say like clockwork there. It can be weird, but it generally it's fairly predictable. And then, you know, one of the other things to note it, with the strong breeze, you can get a lot of, you know, serious chop when the current is against the tide. It could really get churned up in the harbor, even though you're inside and pretty well protected, pretty good. So you want to kind of be prepared for that and kind of adjust your setup accordingly. Here's just a little rundown of the, you know, whole area, which some of you guys already know. I can't see it, but at the top of my screen is the whole, you know, harbor resort. Quantum's going to have like a sail repair little and service desk set up. Be a bunch of us around there. I will be down there for anybody that's, I'm sailing on a J70, but I'll be available to help people. I'll be walking the docks. I'll be there Wednesday and Thursday to try to help out. Anybody that has questions can give me a call or try to get me to, you know, flag me over, and I'm happy to step on your boat if I have time and help out as best I can. But there'll be a bunch of us down there. So looking forward to that. Here's some other useful links that are on here. This is the other one I was talking about, how to photograph sail shape. That's on the Quantum Sails website. then the rig plan was on there. The offshore, you know, the one design page that has the quick tune guide and all of our information. And then here's that YouTube video again, that had the Charleston Harbor tides. So yeah, just wanted to kind of go over that. I don't have any real secret sauce to Charleston other than really being prepared for the tides and making sure your boat handling is pretty crisp. You know, if you can outset and jibe and do a jibe set and those kinds of things a little better than your competition, chances are you're going to be pretty successful, right? There isn't a ton of runway where you're really flexing your boat speed muscles there. You're really more just kind of being, you know, outsmarting your competition with the current and sort of being a little quicker to react. Those are the things you want to focus on. So.
Yeah, Chris, Andy asked if you could just bounce back to your max.
Well, that's kind of all I have. I know there's plenty of things I probably meant to show and go over that I could have, but it's, you know, with limited time, it's hard to get too crazy. So if anyone has any questions, wants to chat into Troy, we could maybe unmute a few people if we dare. And, you know, I don't want to take too much more time, but open it up a little bit.
Yeah. So can you hear me, Chris? So Chris, can you hear me?
Now I can, yes.
Okay, sorry about that. Hey, Andy asked if you could just bounce back real quick to the Max Ebb slide that you had. I think he was trying to take a quick screenshot. Either that or just email him the slide.
Okay.
for Charleston.
Okay. Okay. I'm nervous of every time I'm sharing my voice sort of cuts out. So I'll send that around if I can do that. I'd rather not go back to that and lose my audio again. If I can help it. Sorry.
Yeah. A question came up from Brian. Spin takedown system, please, worth the upgrade?
All right. Yeah, again, that's, you know, if it were my boat, I'd have it. I guess I'll say that. But plenty of boats I've sailed on are successful without it. It's really, like, I think I would recommend, you know, trying to get on a boat that has it and maybe kind of try it or talk to people that have it other than me and see what they think. You know, I think when it's rigged well, I think it's nice, but again, I don't want to talk you into something that, you know, there is a little bit of a learning curve to it. You know, once the boat I sailed on quite a bit and one other that used it, you know, after the first couple of days, it went, you know, went really well, most, you know, 95% of the time.
Let's see, Graham asked me to put Andy on. So Andy, I'm not sure if Graham's just putting you on the spot or what, but I have given you the ability to be able to talk if you'd like.
Oh, yeah, thanks. No, Kris and Troy, thanks both. I don't know what Graham was asking for, but I appreciate your help. And if someone has questions, but Kris did a great job. So thanks.
I got you. All right. Didn't mean to put you on the spot there. I thought maybe you had something. You can get back a Graham for that one, I guess. All right.
Thanks.
Listen, we're an hour and a half into this, and really appreciate everyone taking the time to join us here. Unless anybody has another pressing question now, like I said, certainly feel free to reach out to any of us after the presentation or sometime here coming up in the next couple of weeks. Kris mentioned the team we'll have down in Charleston. And again, many of us, we float around the docks here in the Great Lakes region throughout the whole summer. Really excited to seeing boats on the water again. For most of you, Harbor Springs, the UGOT event may or may not be an option. But right now I've learned the event is already sold out because there is a bit of a limitation the town puts on the boats that come into town for that. But there is a waiting list. So if you've got some interest, I'd encourage you to jump on and get on the waiting list as quickly as you can too, if that's an option. But again, thanks to John and Andy and really the whole group here for allowing us to join you for an hour and a half this evening. And Kris, for sure, all the input you have has been awesome. Again, really appreciate that opportunity.
Yeah.
I'll sign off here for now. I'm going to stop the recording here. And if I've done it right, we should be able to share that information with everybody. And I think that's it.
All right. Well, thank you, Troy. And hopefully you guys learn some things. I'm always available to, to call or email. I love talking 88. So if anybody can find me on Quantum's page or email me, call me. Happy to help out any way I can. It's a great boat and a great fleet. So good luck.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Have a good evening.
All right. Bye-bye.